Part three. Part three is my focus is the 20th century. That's when humans really begin to dominate the fire regime on the peninsula. And so what I do in that is I start with a portrait of the fire geography of the peninsula. Because what strikes me about a lot of writing on fire is you either have the fire people, the ecology people writing about the natural fire regime, or that's really mainly what it is. And the interesting thing about the Cape Peninsula is this wildland-urban interface where you've got this big, what does Stephen Pine call it? It's more like a scrambled eggs. It's a wildland-urban intermix, muddle, if you like, of houses and developments and introduced plants and indigenous plants. It's a kind of unique situation. And if you've done all your training burning mountain catchments out there, it's not that helpful for dealing with the scenario here. So I try and trace the history of, I really thought I would just find someone who'd written this. It's just painful. I try and trace the development of Cape Town as a city and concentrating on things like transport and roads and transitions from, all transport being pulled by animals to railways and cars. I mean, a lot of fires were from steam trains. Electrification made a huge difference. You know, everyone used open flames here. Before there was refrigeration, all your meat was walking around on Signal Hill here, and of course they burnt for that purpose. So there was a lot of fire here. And so the urbanization of the town really changed things, and the extension of the roads, the freeways round and down towards Muizenberg in the end, and the development of suburbs all the way along kind of cut off the peninsula from the flats and really changed the fire geography, if you like. And it's only really in the 60s and 70s that the southern peninsula is really opened up to people, day trippers, and it used to be a bit of work to go down there. So I try and trace this. I just show how the fire geography of the peninsula has changed, what it was and how that's changed. And that's a framework for what comes after. And what comes after then is the conservation history, quite briefly. And really what I try and do there is show just what different visions people have for the peninsula. You know, the botanists wanting the pure, the fynbos and everything else taken out, including my grandfather, John Bond, who was raging about this in the 1950s. And then you had the foresters who wanted to beautify the mountain with trees, this horrible, bleak, wind-swept place. And there's that Ozymandias sort of moment when up above the King's Block and below the King's Blockhouse, up above Rhodes Men, there's the Jarman Memorial. I don't know if you know that, but there's the there was the old cottage, Forrester's cottage there, which they've knocked down, but they've just left the bit of wall with his kind of tribute, because he died, I think, somewhere out, I don't know if it was the Hutt Holland or where it was, but Elgin possibly, he was killed in a fire actually, but he was remembered for foresting the barren wastes of there, and I've got this picture in the book of this, he found this place barren and treeless or something, and he left it clothed with beautiful forest. And of course, all you can see is one or two dead trees in the background, and it's all gone, you know, this poor guy. He would weep. So, and to me, that's a sort of iconic example of how people's ideas of what the mountain should be have changed. Some really fundamentally different ideas. And the other thing I do is show in that chapter the disjunction between the development of scientific thinking. So there were guys like Richard Adamson who, when they first got here, had a Northern Hemisphere vision of fire and raged against how fires were making the mountain barren, but actually were really smart ecologists. And by the time that he wrote this Vicks report, he'd realized he was wrong, and he changed his mind, and he spoke out, credit to him. So there were people who'd seen it, but the public imagination certainly hadn't followed that at all. And in 1962, if you go around, drive around the peninsula, and I saw several actually here, there's the Borki, the famous tearful Bork. And in the original one, and these ones that they kind of cropped, in the original one you can see Table Mountain and Lion's Head in it. And that went viral, as they would now say. But I mean, that's, as a kid growing up in KwaZulu-Natal and Zululand, there were these tearful bokkies in the forestry plantations. And it was a picture book, and it was very popular and very impactful, aimed at kids mainly, and it's quite clever to sort of shame your parents into not throwing those stompies and lighting those fires. And a very strong thing about invasive plants in there as well. And it's a terrible story. It's like, you know, Bambi, there's also a tragic fire, and, you know, the rescued by the Mandy sort of forestry firefighters and nursed back to health. Very touching tale, and it made a big impact. And the big impact was fire is bad. So you had a very strong popular narrative in the newspapers. Every time there was a fire, you know, mountain beauty ruined, you know, wreck and ruin on the mountain. Of course, it's not great for tourism, right? You know, people come out for their holiday and there's charcoal. What's very interesting is the aesthetic way, the aesthetic appreciation of the mountain changes. All the descriptions back from the early Levaillant and those early Sparman, they describe the fires in awe, in terms of awe, but in terms of the beauty of the fire. Because it is impressive. I mean, anyone who's been here and seen a big fire, it's kind of beautiful. And that stops. You can almost, around about 1950 or post-war, it's the end of it. It's interested me, and my theory, open to correction, is that really, once the city has expanded up enough that it's really at the edge of... It's nice when you were down here and you could see the fire playing up there, but when actually it's right on the edge of Deopark or whatever, it's a much less amusing spectacle. So you have the stories in the paper of people running out of those rotunda towers with their pajamas on fire and, you know, desperately with the hose pipe spewing their gardens. And the kind of sense of humor and beauty seems to tail off around about then.